Chapter 14, Survival and the Earth Changes. As usual, it's up to each of us to set priorities, which will ultimately depend on the quality of our thinking, the intensity of our commitment to serve, and our ability to walk in balance. After many of my lectures, I'm asked about upcoming Earth changes. People want to know what will happen, where it will happen, and of course, what we should do about it all. While I am in no way a prophet along the lines of those who make predictions, I could be considered one in the old Greek sense of the word, in which prophet is defined as one who speaks out. I certainly have my own ideas about the future, as we all do, but I prefer not to dwell much on this kind of speculation. While I do think it is important to consider what may be ahead, it's essential to put this whole matter in perspective. Regardless of what happens, our path of learning continues. I must say, however, I was not always so calm about Earth changes, and for me, it's been a process of getting a general outline of basic prophecies, considering my personal role and function during the tumult when and if it occurs, and then putting the predictions on my own reactions into a clearer perspective. This kind of balancing usually leads us to ask, what should I do? Which is the first step in starting to face our priorities. I used to frame this issue in quite narrow terms, i.e. being selfish or selfless, which led to a dichotomy between saving your skin or serving the world. Today, however, I don't think our personal survival decisions have to be an either-or choice, since many good-hearted people will choose a middle way, voluntary withdrawal to so-called safe spots, remaining with friends and colleagues, and continuing their work, which for most of us will involve some sort of service. Regardless of the particular changes that do occur, such as geological and social upheaval, there will be a growth of spiritual communities of like-minded people. Actually, this gathering is already underway, and I know more than a few people who have moved from cities to remote areas. I am sure this will accelerate in the next 5 to 10 years. I must confess, though, that I was quite shocked when first reading the Law of One in the late 1980s and coming upon their response to a pointed question about the coming planetary changes. Ra answered in no uncertain terms, quote, "The Earth changes, or the changes, are very, very trivial. We do not concern ourselves with the conditions which bring about a harvest." Well, that's certainly easy to say if you're sitting in the safety of higher dimensions. However, Ra's comment does reveal an important perspective, a view probably shared by other elder ET groups whose main purpose is to support human evolution. In their opinion, earthquakes, floods, and tornadoes are simply additional catalysts which may or may not be used to develop greater awareness as we continue our endless journey on the path of soul evolution, continually refining love, wisdom, and the realization of one with all that is. Ra considers Earth changes to simply be the outer conditions associated with Earth's transformation, just a byproduct of millennia of human disharmony. They consider such changes somewhat inevitable on our 3D world as we move through global graduation to what they call fourth density, a dimension characterized by selfless love and compassion. To souls who live to serve and grow, global upheaval is just part of the landscape, really no big deal. In 1981, when asked exactly where Earth is in its movement into the new cycle, Ra spoke from the perspective of Earth itself as it struggles to accommodate new cosmic energies while still straining beneath a dysfunctional, destructive civilization. Quote, "This sphere, Earth, is at this time in fourth dimension vibration. Its material is quite confused due to the society memory complexes, societies, embedded in its consciousness. It has not made an easy transition to the vibrations which beckon, therefore it shall be fetched with some inconvenience." Interestingly, they note that Earth is already in its new vibration, which some people can even now feel through an intuitive sense of greater light. Yet, these massive inconveniences will affect all of us, Earth, humanity, and the many spiritual beings here to assist the birth of a new world. How can we consider them just trivial? Why does Ra treat them so lightly? Well, the answer is a little subtle. From the perspective of those who shepherd Earth's transformation, which happens to be the main galactic event attracting so many extraterrestrial races here, geologic upheaval is like Gaia's labor pains, not ultimately necessary, but inevitable in this particular family. ET elders understand that their greatest service to humanity is not rendered by focusing on the pain, nor by giving specific predictions, but rather by alleviating it as much as possible. This they have chosen to do through continual spiritual encouragement and a wise emphasis on the principles of personal transformation and soul evolution. In other words, ageless wisdom. Earth changes are considered simply a consequence, a result of cumulative human disharmony over the ages that continues to take its toll on the body of our planet. Likewise, the severity of upheaval depends entirely on the intensity of the cause. Since the quality of human consciousness is the primary cause, so too is human consciousness the solution. Therefore, the more love and light we generate, the less intense these inconveniences will be. And so, we come to a deeper understanding of the work of wanderers. Their presence is intended to bring love light, which adds needed energy to Earth's transformation, lessening the severity of geological disaster. Their contribution is made, to some extent, whether or not the starseed awakens to his or her own cosmic origin. Although service is usually far more effective when they do pierce the veil of forgetting, since this increases self-understanding. Realizing one's ET identity is not ultimate, but it is an important first step in the right direction. For those who have been asleep to their own cosmic roots, it represents a greater appreciation of truth, and esoterically, potentially greater radiation of light. Of course, such light can also be offered by anyone who lives from the heart and walks in kindness and balance. But again, from our perspective, can we reasonably tell someone who's just lost their home in an earthquake that their upheaval is merely trivial, simply the result of centuries of human psychic disharmony? This kind of response would seem to be the height of spiritual arrogance and insensitivity. How can you tell parents whose family possessions were carried off by floods that it's simply a matter of, quote, additional catalyst for your increased polarity on the path of service to others, end quote? Clearly, we have to make adjustment to the realities of time and space and to the perspective and needs of those who do not perceive the spiritual dimensions of planetary change. All upheaval generates pain, and the work of those who serve is to comfort and support those in pain. Being sensitive to sorrow, we cannot minimize others' emotional loss. In many cases, it is entirely inappropriate to share our version of deeper metaphysics at hand, at least at that time. I have no doubt there will be Earth changes continuing unabated for the next 10 years, until the end of the cycle around 2010-2013 AD and beyond. I do not know exactly what changes will occur, though I tend to agree with the general predictions offered by current and ancient prophecy. You can check the books by Sunbear, Gordon Michael Scallion, and Dolores Cannon for some details, although some of it may be dated. In the years ahead, we will probably need to make many tough choices, and our sensitivity to inner guidance will be essential. Without a doubt, there were lightworkers in the biblical city of Sodom, in the chaos of towns quivering in the last throes of Atlantis, in Hiroshima, Nagasaki, and the Warsaw Ghetto. We cannot assume their presence there was a mistake. For myself, I've become much clearer about my priorities, which means doing my work till the end, wherever and whenever that may be. As always, it's up to each of us to set priorities, whether we're a wanderer or not, which will ultimately depend on the quality of our thinking, the intensity of our commitment to serve, and our ability to walk in balance. While love counsels self-sacrifice, clear wisdom does reject untimely martyrdom. There will be countless opportunities for service, learning, and intensified personal growth in the next 10 years, and while I would not exactly say Earth changes are trivial, they are simply the physical consequences of metaphysical causes in human history. Whatever they will be, our work remains the same. As all crisis brings challenge, these crises will provide a clear challenge to our values, and the best preparation we can make is internal. Knowing our values and why we're living here on Earth. In the Buddha's original teaching of the Noble Eightfold Path, right view was considered a central factor. In the next decade, a balanced view of global events and the right use of catalyst will be a key to our growth. In the next chapter, we will see how the UFO research community is meeting some of these issues, especially the question of the ET presence.